Jogging with the Giants. Do you remember 2 weeks ago when I started this series, we talked about Noah coming down from the stands. And just imagine, look with me in Hebrews chapter 11. Verse 22 says, by faith Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel and gave instructions concerning his bones. And then if you would turn one page, or maybe in your Bible, it's the same page, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, we believers also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily besets or ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. It's a marathon, remember? 28 miles, 365 yards. It's a marathon, not a sprint. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So I describe for you this scene. Let me describe it again for those of you who were not here. Imagine, if you will, that you're in the marathon because you're a believer, and you're running the marathon race of life. And it's a long, arduous race. And you don't think you can finish, but you've trained and you've prepared your body and you're playing by the rules and you're looking unto Jesus. Your mindset is on the finish line. That's the goal. And you're not going to look at the crowd because it'll distract you. You're not going to look at the competition that's beside you and behind you. You're just focused on the finish line. Jesus Christ standing there. It tells us in Revelation and Thessalonians, he's going to be the one judging us at the Bema and giving us our rewards, right? So he's there at the finish line. We should focus on him. But there's this great cloud of witnesses. In chapter 11 of Hebrews tells us all about the heroes of the faith. And if you want a quick Bible study tonight when you go home before you go to bed, think about all those in the Bible that didn't make the heroes of the faith, but they could. They could have. Maybe they should have. And maybe you think you should be in there. I don't know. But the Bible was written thousands of years ago, not today. So, you know, you can't maybe be included. But the truth is, you've got those heroes and heroines. And so we're talking about those. And I talked about how Noah came down out of the crowd. And he was an old man, rugged skin. Man, his hands, when he shook your hand, you knew you'd been shaking the hand of someone who really had pounded a lot of wooden nails into that boat. So I want you just to think about that. As Noah makes his way back up into the grandstands after he's encouraged us to keep on and not to quit, out of the grandstands we see another person coming down to run the race with us and jog beside us as we're jogging with the Giants. And he's going to encourage us. And his name is none other than Joseph. And he's dressed in really weird clothing. We recognize that it's an Egyptian headdress on his head. And we say, aren't you Joseph? And he said, yes, I am. And I've got some encouraging words to say to you. And he wants to encourage us. So he starts running along beside us to encourage us as we're running the last few laps, because we're running the marathon, but we've entered the stadium for the last few miles of the race that we're running. And we're going to do laps in the stadium. And so lots of heroes of the faith are coming out of the stands, and they've got some tips and some words of encouragement for us. And this is exactly what Joseph is going to say to us. He gets down to the bottom. He starts jogging with us, and he says, don't lose sight of the finish line. He says, don't ever give up on your dreams. Don't ever give up on your dreams. Turn to the person next to you and say, don't ever give up on your dreams. Stephen, who in the world are you talking to, dude? All right, he wants to remind us, because I'm certain that for at least 13 years of his life, he thought, God, how are you going to make this come true? How? He was 17 when some things happened in his life, and they all started happening at that time. So if you would, turn with me to Genesis chapter 37 and look about the life of Joseph and how it all started. Now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah. You know who that is. That was, Jacob loved one woman, had his eyes on her, but he got fooled because he was a schemer. He got fooled by her daddy. So he married the oldest and then wanted 7 more years for the youngest. And then he got their maidservants too. So he's got 4 wives or women, which God never condoned. He condemned it in the word. But there's grace even in the Old Testament. So those are the two ladies who are the maidservants of his wives, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. When you understand the family dynamics there and the dysfunctions of that home, I don't think there could have been a good report that Joseph could have brought. Do you? Those were troubled boys. So Joseph brings just a report, and it happens to be bad, because it's not that he's a tattletale. He's telling his dad what's going on with his father's flocks. But his brothers are out in the field, and they are misbehaving. They're not doing good. So Joseph tells his father the truth. Now, Israel loved Joseph more than all his children. Why? Because he was the son of his old age. And this was part of custom of their day. When you're an old man, a sign that you still got it is that you can have a son when you're an old man. And this is why Joseph was his favored son. One reason was because, he loved Rachel. And she was the woman that he really wanted to marry in the first place, but they couldn't conceive for all those years and all the dealings that he had done to others. What goes around comes around. He got it right back. So they finally had a son. His name was Joseph. And Joseph's a fine boy. And his father loved him because, it was the son of him as he's an old age, and it was the son of none other than Rachel. I don't know if many of you read, but I was reading yesterday, and I read that Richard Gere is 70. And I know some of you are older than that, but Richard Gere just had another child with his, I think, 3rd or 4th wife. So he's just said, I said, man, he's going to be 88 years old when that son graduates from high school. He'll be too old to even go to the graduation, but more than likely. But I mean, it looks good, but he's still having kids. So he was the son of Jacob at a late age, and he was a favored son. Also, he made him a tunic of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. You thought that was just your family. Seriously, I mean, all of us have issues within our families, but some of us more than others. This family is very, very dysfunctional. And it's got lots of wounds. And you might think that you're alone in all that you're going through, but Jacob's family was messed up, and look how God used that family. Now, Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. Now, listen, right in the margins of your Bible, there's a lot of commentaries that say he was very immature, and he shouldn't have done that. Well, that may be true that he was immature at 17, but God had Joseph to tell his brothers and his father about his dream. God did that for a reason. And that reason still coming true in our age. Did y'all hear me? That reason is still coming true. All of this promise has not been fulfilled as of yet. God is still fulfilling his promises today. So Joseph told his brothers and his father the dream, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaf rose and also stood upright. And indeed, your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf. And his brother said to him, shall you indeed reign over us, or shall you indeed have dominion over us? So they hated him even more for his dream and for his words. Then he dreamed still another dream and told it to his brothers and said, look, I have dreamed another dream. This time the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down unto me. It's very important that you underline that. The sun, representing his father. The moon, representing what? His mother. and 11 stars bowed down to me. Now that's very important in this passage, so you might want to keep that mindful. So he told it to his father and his brothers, and his father rebuked him and said to him, "What is this dream that you've dreamed? Shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come to bow down to the earth before you?" And his brothers envied him, but his father kept the matter in mind. It's really quite important. Joseph now is running alongside the track with us as we jog the last 2 or 3 miles of this marathon. And Joseph turns to us and he says, "First of all, I want to tell you, don't ever forget the dreams of your youth. Don't forget the dreams of your youth. Don't forget the dreams of your youth." You may say, now there's a difference between what you and I dream and what God gives us to dream. If you've ever studied or read anything on dreams, most people have 6 to 8 dreams a night. Rarely do we remember them. They're never in color. If you have colorful dreams, it's because you're drinking at night. But there's a difference. I mean, I have had some reoccurring dreams in my life where I believe God can speak to you, not through your dreams, but a dream is nothing more than the subconscious speaking to the conscious. You think about it. You can watch a movie or a show late at night and go to bed and dream that you're one of the characters in the movie, and that's not a godly dream. You can go and have some spicy food or Hispanic Mexican food and have bad dreams at night, and that doesn't mean that dream's from God, you know. But there's a difference. And we know the Bible tells us in former days, in latter days, that God spoke to us through dreams and visions. But now he speaks to us through his word, through the Holy Spirit, through prayer, through the church, those kind of things. It doesn't mean, though, that God can't still speak to our subconscious as it speaks to our conscious. I've had some dreams where I really think God is speaking to me, and I've tried to figure them out. But there's a big difference between a God-given dream and a human dream, a manly or a womanly dream. There's a huge difference. This dream that Joseph had is from the Lord, and he couldn't figure it out, and it was troubling him. He didn't tell his brothers bragging. He's troubled by it. He can't imagine this happening. This is a dream, and he's telling his brothers, but they take it wrong. Here's the reason why Joseph had a right heart about this. His heart was good towards his brothers. He thought because he loved them, they would love him. But that dream even made them madder, didn't it? It made them madder. And he thought they would never respond to him the way he would respond to them. But they did respond adversely to Joseph. We can't control the way that other people react to the dreams that you and I have in life. So Joseph's just reminding us as we jog down the track. He's like, don't forget the dreams of your youth. Don't give up on that dream. He was only 17 when he had these two dreams. One of the greatest gifts of life is seeing your children come to Christ at an early age in life. For when they do, we can begin molding and shaping their lives early on. Hopefully and prayerfully, they will begin to dream great dreams for the Lord and not just for themselves. There's nothing wrong with dreaming to get rich and wealthy. Nothing at all. In fact, America was founded on dreams like that. But you'll find that the founding fathers of our country, most of them who were very wealthy, had great dreams and vision of God blessing them so that they could be a blessing to the country that God founded. So it's like James teaching in his book, Half Brother of Jesus Christ. He's like, God gives you wealth not for you and I to hoard it, but rather to help others and to cast the hope of Christ in the present age. So Joseph is having these dreams. There's nothing wrong with a human dream, but if your dreams are all about you and all about what you think success is, begin saying as you pray, God, make my dreams to be godly, Christ-like dreams. Because as we've read in Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, the goal is to become like Christ, and for the joy that was laid before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame, and is now sat down at the right hand of God the Father. All of what Satan promised him in the 3 temptations of Christ in the desert Christ got when he sat down on the right-hand side of God the Father. But that was not Satan to give. Your hopes, your dreams, your aspirations may be in the earthly, but it should be in the eternal. So make certain that you're having godly dreams. Don't forget, he says, the dreams of your youth. Then he says to us, here's my second point to you. As we jog around that track, he leans in, he says to us, don't forget, there's going to be adversity in obtaining your dreams. Now, we don't like that today. We don't like adversity. But the greatest generation that our country has ever produced is sitting right here in this auditorium from the ages of 65 up. You've gone through a lot of stuff in our country's life. You've endured, and you're still standing. You're still sitting. You're still existing. It doesn't hurt your kids to go through adversity. It doesn't hurt your children to suffer a little bit for the cause of their country, for the cause of their family. There's nothing wrong with going through adverse time, but I want you to think about this. For Joseph, he never knew that his dreams would cost him so much. No pain, no gain. The greatest of life aspirations, hopes, and dreams are typically not found in shallow waters. I don't know if you read at all about hidden treasures in the oceans, but I find myself reading about them because people are still hunting them quite often. And most of the greatest treasures ever to be found are way, 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 way down into the depths of the oceans. And it takes lots of money, and it takes lots of manpower, and it takes a lot of willpower to go after those treasure chests. Your dreams, your treasures are not more than likely going to be found in shallow waters. You've got to go deeper. You've got to cast out and allow the Lord to say, let's go deeper together. Let's find out the hidden treasures of life. And man, Joseph had to go deep, deep, deep to get to his dreams. For King David, Jephthah, Joseph, Ruth, and many other heroes of the faith, some of the greatest adversity resulted in even brothers and sisters rejecting them. Jesus Christ is in that lot too. Brothers and sisters didn't believe that he was the one. Mark chapter 6. All of these that I just listed, these four, King David, Joseph, Jephthah, Ruth, these are people that were rejected by family and friends, even country, before they came into the dreams of their youth. Did you think it was going to be that easy to capture and go after your dream? It's not much of a dream if it's found in shallow water. Anyone and everyone can come along in shallow water and pick out the treasures. I watch on Friday nights Gold Rush. Any other Gold Rushers here? I like Gold Rush. I don't know why my wife teases me. She's like, it's the same show every week. I don't know why you watch. I don't like the language of the show, but I love the end of the show a lot because it shows what each of those guys are going after. And now there's ladies on the show too, but what's crazy is how much gold they can find. But it's also nuts how much dirt they have to go through to find just a speck of gold. And if all of us could find gold that way, we'd all be doing it, right? That's your dreams. If everyone could go and find it, well, it wouldn't be yours. It's special because it's your dream. And if God laid it on your heart, you've got to go for the gold. You've got to go for the dream. Don't just give up. So he's encouraging us. There's going to be adversity. Know that. Get through it. Thirdly, he says, don't forget, the race of life has many detours, but they're not dead ends. It has many detours, but they're not dead ends. Joseph reminds us his own brothers were the ones that threw him into the pit. Then he reminds us of the irony of the Ishmaelites. Look with me, if you would. In chapter 37, the brothers, verse 25, They sat down to eat a meal. Then they lifted their eyes and looked, and there was a company of Ishmaelites, underline that, coming from Gilead with their camels, bearing spices, balm, and myrrh on their way to carry them down to Egypt. So Joseph said to his brothers, what profit is there? Judah said to his brothers, what profit is there if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites. Let not our hand be upon him, for he's our brother in our flesh. He's wanting to make points with his dad because he messed up. That's why Judah did that. Reuben threw him in the pit instead of killing him because, well, Reuben's really messed up with his dad's concubine. This is a messed up family. So they're all trying to get brownie points from dad, and they're all trying to scheme their own way. And remember now, Galatians 6, verse 7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. My dad always marked in my Bible beside that the law of retribution, what goes around comes around. Jacob is getting that which he dished out all these years. That's why so many dysfunctions in his family. But here's Joseph, and he's not done anything. And he's catching all this flack. And he's going through adversity. But the other thing he's doing is God's just putting him on a detour because God has a master plan. God has a master plan, and he's getting Joseph there. He can't just walk him there on Golden Street. He's got to get him there, but to get there, he's got to put Joseph on some roads that look like dead ends to Joseph, but Joseph remained faithful. He didn't give up on his dream that God had given him. He didn't give up on when the adversity came into his life because he kept trudging through. How do we know that? Well, he overcame. Watch this now. He hit detour after detour. The irony of the Ishmaelites. You remember where the Ishmaelites came from. They were the cast outs. Think of this. Now, you got a woman named Hagar, and Abraham's got this plan to have children. But he can't get it done with Sarah. She's barren. So Sarah comes to Abe and says, hey, Abe, my maidservant. This will get it done. It'll be my child. Let's just help God along a little bit. So they have a son. His name is Ishmael. God said, that's not my chosen one. I've got a plan for him, but Abraham, you've messed up. Don't take my will into your own hands. Let me have control of this. And Abe couldn't learn that lesson. So finally, God says to Abraham, put her out like your wife has said. Now, I'm not saying to you gentlemen that you should do everything your wife tells you to do. But in this case, Abraham's saying to God, I don't think I can do this to my son. It's not his fault what I've done. And it's not Hagar's fault. I mean, Sarah and I did this together. And God said, no, Abraham, listen to your wife. Put her out. Put him out. He's not the son of promise. Now there's 2 billion people on our planet today that think that he was the son of promise, don't they? If you know what I'm talking about. But he's not. God said, put him out. Now watch, this is how God takes the fabric of your life and my life, and he weaves it together. When we take things into our own hand, we think we're in control, but God's like, no, you're not. I'm still in control. So Abraham puts Hagar and his son Ishmael out, not even know if they'd have a next meal. God took care of them. They land up in a land, in a place that's foreign to them. And they start having kids and children and descendants. And then they're on a caravan, and they're going through this land. And one day, this boy, this 17-year-old boy, has been thrown in a pit. And some men drag him out and say, would you like to pay for a slave? And they're just saying, sure, we'll give you 20. And they give them 20, not even the price of a slave, because they're into making money. But God's prepared the Ishmaelites. The irony of this story, God's prepared the Ishmaelites to take Joseph where God's going to preserve him. So they take him down. They take him down to Egypt where his brothers cannot get him, and where God's going to, years later, deliver his children to that place so that they can survive a drought that the whole world's going to have. It was not a dead end. It was a detour. Joseph yielded. went with the Ishmaelites, I'm sure he cried the whole way, wondering, how's my dream going to come true? He gets down there, they put him on the slave block, and none other than Potiphar buys him up. And Potiphar puts him into his house, and he's doing all this stuff for Mr. Potiphar. It's amazing. Everything that Joseph does, it turns to gold. Potiphar's like, I'm going to turn everything in my house over to you. And even my wife, I trust you with everything, Joseph. The wife can't get that boy to yield to her. Little Joe is in trouble every day. She's trying to tempt him, but he does not yield to temptation. He's saying to her, how can I do this to my master? How can I do this to God? I'm not going to do this. She takes his tunic, his garment. She accuses him of rape. And then her husband, who must not have believed Mrs. Potiphar, because the Egyptian rule of law was if a foreigner is even accused of something like that, you cut him, you get rid of him, you're dead. But he didn't. He put him in the slammer. So Joseph's gone from the pit to Potiphar's house and now into the slammer, the prison. And he's thinking to himself, God, what are you doing? What a dead end I'm in. Are you there tonight? You think to yourself, man, I don't know if it can get any lower than where it's at right now. That was where Joseph was. He was thinking to himself, there's no way out. This is a prison. But wouldn't you know it? Two of Pharaoh's cabinet members are put into prison. They both have a dream. Well, the baker's dream didn't turn out so well for him. Joseph told him the truth. He told him the end of it. Get yourself ready for it. Time. And then there's the butler. And Joseph says to the butler, man, you're going to be restored in less than 3 days. You're going to get out, and everything's going to be fine. And I'm sure the butler's like, sure. But then it happened. And as he's leaving, right before he goes out of the prison, right? You got the picture in your head? Joseph's saying, thank you, God. You allowed all this for a reason. Phew. I'm finally going to get out of this joint. This is hope. I know I'm getting out. So Joseph says, don't forget me. I've been on a detour for many, many years. It's been a long, long time. Don't forget me, buddy. And the butler says, I could never forget you. But he did. Have you ever had a friend who got a job or knew a friend who could get you a promotion and you said, don't forget me. I helped you. I stroked yours. You stroked mine. Help me out, buddy. I'll sure do it. And they don't. And you're forgotten. And you think, another dead end. After a few weeks, what do you think Joseph's thinking in the prison? That guy got out. He's probably taking all the credit for the things that happened. But God had a time. Listen, Joseph's now running alongside of us, and he's saying, don't give up. A detour is not a dead end. Don't give up. Remember your dreams. So 2+ years, and the Pharaoh has a dream. And Joseph gets out. And you know the rest of the story. And the brothers are now 3 years later, after Joseph's doing all the, you know, the 7 years of plenty and the 7 years, and they're in that 7-year drought. There's no crops anywhere. And Jacob says to his sons, 10 of them, he's like, go down there to Egypt. You got to appear before this guy, and he's divvying out what's left, and you got to just appeal to him. And the providence of God, all those detours, they were not dead ends. Maybe you're not at a dead end. Maybe this is a detour. You've got Joseph in the Bible. You've got Joseph. We've got Joseph in our Bible to tell us it may look like a dead end to you, but it's just a detour. A prison detour, possibly. It's not the best place to be, but a prison can and has led to a palace in the past. So don't think that God's left you behind. God is, according to John 14, in my Father's house are what? Many mansions. If it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I what? I will come again that where I am. You might be right now in a prison, but I can guarantee you, if you're a believer, every single one of us tonight, there's a palace that we're going to. And we're going to be princes and priests and kings and leaders. Are you ready for the rewards? Now, Joseph's getting ready to get off the track, run up the steps. But he's got three quick tips that he wants to leave with us. He said, I want you to know this because these are encouraging words I want to give you. Remember this. He says, God kept my brothers from killing me. They could have killed him. That would have been an easy way. Just take the blood, say an animal got to him. But no, there was another plot. God was in that. They could have killed him. Joseph saying, man, my brothers could have killed me, but God kept their hand. He stayed their hand. God can stay the hands of evil people for you and me. He's in that business. Then secondly, he says, God kept Potiphar from killing me too. He should have. The law said, I'm a foreigner. His wife had proof that I was in the home. She was saying, I did this. It was my word against hers. And who's going to attest that she was lying? No one's going to embarrass a leading cabinet member like Potiphar and his wife. He should have killed me, but God kept him from killing me. And then he looks at us and he says this, God kept the butler from remembering me. I had a guy in a church years ago who was in the band, and his dad sang often in the church. This guy wanted a job really bad, and he came to me and said, will you pray with me? He told me the name of the company, and I said to him, hey, isn't that company really pro a lot of things that the Bible is against? And he's like, yeah, but they pay, preacher, if I could have that job for 2 years, I could put so much away. I'm like, I don't know if you really want that job. I don't think I can pray with you. They're a very, very, very liberal company. I don't think I'll see you much on Sunday if you start working for that company. And I don't know if I want to pray that way. Oh, Pastor, I prayed about it. I know this is what God wants. He's opened all these doors. I'm like, what if Satan is deceiving you and Satan's opening all these doors? He did his thing. He took the job. His mom and daddy were just distraught. It didn't just change him. 3-4 months later, his mom and dad were making excuses of, well, it's a good job. He makes a boatload of money. And it's pretty good. We're going on trips with him. Pretty soon, all three of them out of church often, and his family, his children, we didn't see him much in church either. But he had a great job. 4 years into the job, he's making boatloads of money, and they're having a lot of fun, but they're far distant from God. And that band never saw him play ever again. He's still out in a faraway place, living prodigally. His dad died about a year or two ago. It was a sad funeral because, listen, they didn't have a church that they belonged to even have the funeral. See, the prodigal living takes some of us a long ways farther away than we ever thought. It might offer you. Satan sometimes doesn't have to trash you to get you. He might give you lots of treasures that you think, oh, this must be from God. But if it leads you away from God, it's not his dream. It's not his plan. God kept the butler from remembering Joseph because God's timing was perfect. God never makes mistakes. You may feel passed over for a job, a position, a church position, or even the favored son of your father or mother. You may very well have had that happen to you. You may very well be in a dysfunctional place in your life or a dysfunctional family, but you've not been passed over by God. He's remembered you. Isaiah 49, 15 and 16. Write that down. Isaiah 49 and 15 and 16. See, I've written your name on the palms of my hand. The verse 15 before talks about, can a mother forget the son or daughter of her womb? But I will not forget you. And then you have this text in Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9 that tells us all about how God has prospered and purposed something in our lives for us to do. There's a lot of Josephs today that have had a godly dream, but they've given up on it. They're not seeing it. It's not within your sight. And you say to yourself, well, dead end, dead end. So you've gone the way of the prodigal. Come back to him. Come back to him. Remember the dreams of your youth. Remember, it's going to take some adversity to achieve and realize that dream. And even sometimes friends and family may not see what God has for you. But God hasn't forgotten you. He has not forsaken you. He loves you. He will fulfill his purpose and his dream in your life if you remain faithful to him. Lord, I'm praying for those